My name is Dan Parrish. I'm a member of the Dartmouth class of 1989. I'm the director of the Dartmouth for Life program in the Office of Alumni Relations, and I work with a team of people who sponsor and create educational programming here in Hanover, across the country and around the globe for alumni and parents and friends of the college. And if you're interested in the work that we do, if you go to the Dartmouth alumni website, you'll see all the programs that we run in different places. Some of you have picked up our new travel brochure, and there's a lot of great information in there about the programming that we do. So thank you very much for being with us this morning, and we're excited to have you here. One housekeeping detail before we get started: if you have a cell phone with you and it's on, please silence it or turn it off so that your neighbors won't hear your ringtone later on if somebody tries to get in touch with you. And without further ado, let's get right into this morning's program. I'm very excited and very pleased to welcome Lorie Loeb and to introduce her. Lorie is a research professor in the computer science department at Dartmouth. She's the director of the digital arts program and the executive director of the digital arts Leadership and Innovation Lab. And since that's such a mouthful, we just say that she's the director of the Dali Lab here on campus, and all the students on campus know what the Dali Lab is, and Lorie's gonna talk to you a little bit about what digital arts and leadership means. She's also the president and co-founder of Telemotion Incorporated, a social entrepreneurship startup aimed at motivating people to change behavior and conserve resources. Before coming to Dartmouth, Lorie was a senior research scientist in the computer science department at Stanford University. She holds 2 patents and is the recipient of the Fulbright and the Whiting Foundation fellowships. Lorie is an artist as well as a technologist. The films that she has worked on have won many awards, including 2 Emmys and a Cine Golden Eagle Award. Her animated films have had screenings at the Modern Museum of Art, the Sundance Film Festival, the New York Film Festival, the London Film Festival, and the Whitney Biennial. At the Dali Lab, Lorie and her students design and develop technology tools that merge art, science, design, and technology to help people communicate effectively and maximize impact. I'm really pleased to welcome Lorie, and I hope you'll join me in welcoming her. Thanks.
Sure, thanks. Can you guys hear me okay? Everyone hear me? Thanks for coming. Thanks, Dan. It's really exciting to be speaking to you. I know we have a lot of people who, how many of you are Dartmouth alums? Wow. And then I know we have at least one person who wants to be part of the class of 2020. So that's very exciting. So thanks for coming. I'm going to talk to you, as Dan said, about my work and about the Dali Lab. So first, here's the Dali Lab. At the Dali Lab, we build all kinds of technology tools. There's a lot of information out there, 100 hours of YouTube videos being uploaded every minute, billions of websites, apps, thousands of apps every day, or new apps, and it's overwhelming. And so we help our partners communicate ideas effectively. And I'll tell you more about that in a bit. But first, a little bit about my favorite subject. Oh, actually, this is a quote from John Kemeny. Some of you probably studied with John Kemeny. It's the greatest achievement of a teacher to enable his or her students to surpass him. And I believe that strongly, and that's one of the things that makes Dartmouth so special. So a little bit about me. You heard a bit. I am a professor in the computer science department. Even though I come from an arts background, I'm the director of the digital arts programs. We have an undergraduate and a master's level program, and I'm the executive director of the new Dali Lab. I also live at a farm, Cobb Hill Co-Housing, that was started by a MacArthur Genius Award winner and former faculty member here, Danella Meadows. Some of you may know her work. And I am a beekeeper. So I could do a whole other lecture on beekeeping. Any beekeepers here by any chance? Because we can have a long conversation. It's absolutely awesome. So I wanted to show you a video.
Best friend.
so the video goes on, and he plays in the puddle a little more. He picks up the leash, and they walk off. So this video has been shared about 5 million times. And whenever it's shared, the hero of the story almost always is the dog. Man's best friend, ever patient, waits by the little boy's side. But for me, the hero is the little kid. This kid shows a little understand emotion that I think is delight. So delight isn't one of those top tier Ivy League emotions like happy, sad, angry, surprised. In fact, the dictionary doesn't even really have a good definition for it. It can use it in a sentence. We watch the fireworks with delight. But a strong feeling of happiness, it's a little more than that. So I have a whole theory about it, and I'm studying it, and I'd love to talk to some of you afterwards, because my sense is that delight is the thing that each of you have, the thing that keeps people young and keeps people engaged. But we'll talk about that in a second. So we watch the fireworks with delight. You know that feeling. Your heart starts to race a little bit in anticipation. You're anticipating that the fireworks are coming. You sit forward, your head goes up, and you clap kind of like this. You know that one? Wow. Yeah, that's delight. I feel the same way when I see a circus. Have you, any of you seen Cirque du Soleil or circuses? They delight me. Magic also delights me. In fact, I got into film and animation through magic by working with magicians. I worked at a bank. Anyhow, it's a long story. So Mae Sarton, a New Hampshire poet, said, "The quality of life is in proportion always to the capacity for delight. And the capacity for delight is the gift of paying attention." Nice, right? So when you pay attention and experience something like it's brand new, the beginner's mind is sometimes called, then we're open for delight, right? We have to, that's how it happens. So a lot of my work has been about that. I haven't really named it that, but I've often been about sort of creating, this is a dance film that I did in a sculpture garden about 20 years ago in upstate New York called Opus 40. This is some work that I did here at Dartmouth. This is motion capture work with Merce Cunningham Dance Troupe from New York City. They came up here for a residency for a week, and we took one of his drawings. He did a bunch of drawings, and he had this drawing of a blue-footed booby. And working with Rachel Foreman, who was a student there, an undergrad, doing a presidential scholarship, we built this 3D model, and then in the Bentley Theater over at the Hopkins Center, did this live performance with Merce Cunningham dancers that brought his character, his drawing to life, dancing as part of the troupe with him. It was really quite fun. I worked with the theater department and several faculty members in the theater department, Dan Kotlowitz, Peter Hackett, and Ford Evans, and a whole troupe of undergrads. We worked for a year on a dance piece with projection art that was called Viscera, and it was about the hidden costs of war. We presented that. It was quite an extraordinary experience. Again, with undergrads, there were Brenton Rayner and other undergraduates were working with me to build some characters that were projected. And back in Stanford, when I was at Stanford, I worked on this, this research project that got published at SIGGRAPH, a computer graphics conference, about cartoon capture. It's one of the patents that I hold with Chris Bregler. And I was fortunate enough to work with these brilliant computer scientists. And we were really interested in this idea of motion capture. So when the way motion capture works is there are these cameras, and they have red lights all around the lens. And the dancer or the subject wears these little highly reflective balls, markers, at their joints. And when the light bounces off of the reflection and back, it tells you gives you an XYZ coordinate. And when you have multiple cameras, you get the 3D position in space. So it does that very fast. And that's how a lot of special effects are done. And it was how A lot of the movies that you see are done now, it's called performance capture even. So many movies are done with motion capture these days. So I was interested in that, but I come from an animation background. And so I wasn't really interested in that. I was interested in the more expressive movement up here. So just like visuals can have a whole range of styles, from hyper-realistic to totally abstract, my sense was that so too can movement have different styles. As an animator, I knew that we weren't trying to capture realistic movement, and motion capture, as wonderful as it is at capturing real movement, we wanted to capture a much more expressive type of movement that happens in cartoons. So we went about motion capturing cartoons. It was the first time that was ever done. So basically what we were trying to do is to take the movement of like Bugs Bunny, plop the motion off, and put it onto a photograph of one of you. So then you'd be moving like Donald Duck, or a 3D model, or a drawing. Okay, and this is kind of how it worked. I won't get into too many details, but basically there's this different steps where you grab the cartoon off of the image and you retarget it. You grab the images and then you retarget it. Let me show you what I mean. So here is a frog hopping. And what we do is we take all the affine motions away, and then we look at there are three key or extreme drawings. And if we look at there's how close to each of those key frame drawings each frame is, and we weight it. It's about, you know, 20% this and 30% that and 50% that. And then we take a drawing of a bunny rabbit in three key frames, and we give it the same weights. Now with those three drawings of a bunny rabbit, we now have transferred the hopping of the frog onto the hopping of a bunny rabbit. So let me show you how this could be applied. So here's Bugs Bunny. And you'll see he's kind of exaggerated motion. Right? That's not quite motion capture. And we've retargeted onto a photograph of Charlie Chaplin. Yeah. So that we played around with that for a while. It was a lot of fun. So why does any of this matter, and why do I care about these things? Partly because I like to make people smile or laugh. It's a lot of fun. And partly because I really care about changing, impacting people's lives and their behavior. And I started, because I moved here to live at Cobb Hill, and because Donella Meadows got her MacArthur Award around systems dynamics and sustainability and really trying to understand climate change and why people do what they do. She died tragically of meningitis about 13 years ago. But I decided that I really wanted to focus on climate change. I really wanted to focus especially on behavior. And how the heck do you get students here at Dartmouth to change their behavior and start caring about the energy that they use and start to conserve resources? So I looked at that a little bit, and I realized that, you know, one reason that people change their behavior is because they understand what they're trying to do. They have a goal in mind. So when we see these speeds, these signs, they're getting a little bit, we're seeing them a little bit too much now. We stop paying attention to them quite as much. But when you see this kind of thing, you know where you're trying to get to, and you know what your action, what your behavior is at this moment. It's real-time feedback. And without feedback, we won't change our behavior. If you have no feeling in your finger and you touch a hot stove, you'll keep your finger on that hot stove until you burn your finger off. You just don't, you need to have feedback in order to change your behavior. And here at Dartmouth, across campus, nobody was getting any feedback about their energy use, and especially not students. And they had no skin in the game, in that while in some ways the cost of energy was a part of their tuition, Dartmouth spends about $3 million a year on energy costs. That's a lot. If I use more than you, I don't pay more than you. It's hidden in my tuition bill, it isn't clear, and it isn't, and my behavior doesn't directly affect it one way or another. So there was no real motivation for students, right? They weren't afraid of getting a ticket, and they weren't being rewarded by financial gains, right? So it's really hard. It's a really hard, hard problem. In fact, climate change in general is a hard problem to change people's behavior around for a lot of reasons. So at that time, and this was around 2007, 2008, this was the state of the art. There was a company coming out of Oberlin College called Lucid Design, and they were providing these little graphs and charts to people about their energy use. And this was a company that had just been funded with $100 million to provide feedback in homes. So people knew feedback was important. But my sense was that this wasn't going to change anybody's behavior. What do you think? Unless you're an engineer and you already care, no, but this is not going to get my attention and it's not going to change my behavior. And so, and the other thing that I didn't like about this was that it was no context. I put one of these in my home, and what I found is if I turned on a light, the number went up. If I turned it off, the number went down. It was an absolute value. And I thought, well, duh. You know, the number goes up, I turn something on, and I wanted to know what I should be using or how it relates. I wanted to put it into context. So I had this idea, and I worked with a group of undergraduate students in the computer science department and across campus. And we built a system, and the McLaughlin cluster had just been built, and they had the first digital meters on campus ever. They weren't hooked up or anything. They couldn't read them. So we had them hooked up, and we wrote a polar, and we created a database, and we started collecting data every few seconds, and then looking at past behavior and making a prediction about what electricity use should be at this day and this time with this group. And then if electricity use was better than expected, we had a monitor in the hall, and there was a little polar bear, and the polar bear was happy and healthy. But if electricity use was more than what we predicted, the ice would crack and the bear would fall through. So I'm going to show you a little video that we made about some of
this. This video shows our information visualization system for real-time energy use feedback using animation. Greenlight Dartmouth visualizes complex energy data in a dynamic, compelling, and meaningful interface. Our goal is to encourage people to change behavior in order to conserve resources. Total U.S. energy demand is projected to increase by more than one-third by 2025, with electricity demand rising by almost 40%. Current estimates are that as much as 60% of energy consumption is behavioral and can be reduced through behavioral changes and efficiency improvements. But in order to change behavior, people need information and motivation. We begin with an animation of a polar bear. When energy use is low, the bear is happy. But when energy use is high, the bear's well-being is endangered. At Dartmouth, students have fallen in love with the bear. They named him, and they tell their friends to conserve electricity to prevent him from drowning. Our system was developed by students at Dartmouth as part of a digital arts and computer science project. We pull information from digital meters and store it in a database. Data collected includes plug load, lighting, heat, city water, hot water, energy creation from solar and other renewables, as well as printer usage data. We use historical data to predict expected energy use for a particular time and day. Our mood algorithm scores the current usage and calls up an appropriate animation. Any computer with a web browser can view our display in real time. In fact, the displays update every 5 seconds. Our display shows current time of day and weather. When it's dark in Hanover, it's dark in the display. In fact, everything in our display emphasizes the relationship between the student and the environment. Competitions between dorms further encourage students to conserve resources. We've developed a Flash desktop widget for Mac and PC. Greenlight Dartmouth has already shown significant improvements in resource consumption. We are conducting additional user studies and working with sociologists to understand social norms around energy use. A 3D virtual Dartmouth imported into our game engine allows users to explore the campus and see energy data by building.
So we kept working on this, and we did a new interface. And here's the bear, and the students get a score, and they can see how they compare to the past, and they can the Tuck Business School, a group of outgoing seniors who are having their reunion this weekend too, 10 years ago, they bought the system and put it in the dorms, and so because it was Tuck students, we thought we should create this sort of Bloomberg-like ticker tape, and this little penguin comes and either saves money or wastes money, and they really like that over at Tuck. Here he is doing, you know, changing out a light bulb. So the penguin does a few other things. Here are the graphs, and the graphs are all in context, so you can see, you can compare it to this month, to past months, or to other dorms or other buildings, and you can look at how you've been doing over time, your sort of averages. And then we created this, which is sort of another kind of graph, so you can see how you're doing and how many iTunes songs or cookies you could have bought if you hadn't used so much electricity. So to try to put everything into context and give it meaning. And it was quite successful. It got a lot of press, and we started a company around it, and it's now in data centers and schools around the country. And at one of the schools, they had 55% electricity reduction over a full year. So that's a lot of electricity. That's a lot. When we talk to utilities and they try to get behavior change, they're usually trying to get about 2 or 3%. So to be fair, though, about 20% of that was in that the students got so mad at some lighting that they had in some of the dorms that they forced the school. This was a high school, a boarding high school in Connecticut. They forced the school to change out the lights. So we take the credit for that 20% because they might not have done it, but it was the rest of it, the 35%, was all behavioral changes. And here at Dartmouth, 75% of the students said they looked at the kiosks that were in the hall regularly. So why did it work? What happens? How is it that you can actually motivate people and change their behavior? It's really hard to do. There are people, it turns out, after doing this project, I discovered this whole field of behavioral economics that I hadn't really even known about, but I started to read and talk to it to people, and behavioral economists started contacting me because they thought this was really extraordinary. This notion of creating an emotional connection between the user and data seems to have some meaning and some value. And so they started to study me, and I started to study them. So one of the things that I started to look at was this notion of mental models, how we see the world and how that impacts how we behave. So this is from The Matrix, which may not be a movie that many of you have seen, but it's kind of cool. You should see it if you haven't. Take a moment and take this one in. You get it? What's a mountain goat doing way up here in the cloud bank? Do you think they're really in a cloud bank? And here's another one. So, you know, things are what we think they are. You know, we go in thinking that something will be some way, and that's the way we behave, we act around it. And there's this, I really like this sort of pyramid. It's sometimes thought of as an iceberg under the water. So this is the water level, and this is what we see. So the events that happen. And so, for example, if you're trying to motivate people, and since this Greenlight Dartmouth project, I work a lot with the medical school and with the Center for Technology and Behavioral Health and others to try to change people's behavior to get them to quit smoking or to get them to take better care of themselves or to work on things like anxiety or depression, get people to sleep more here on the campus. And so what people always start with is they start thinking about the events. So let's say we're trying to convince someone to start going to the gym and get more exercise, so to start exercising. So maybe you hold some special event and you get them to come to the gym once or twice. So it's an event, but that won't keep them going to the gym. That changes their behavior over a very, very short period of time. So if you want to change their behavior even more, you know you have to turn it into a trend or a pattern. They have to start coming to the gym. You have to start trying to give them a group of people, like a weekly class. So you start going more regularly, and it starts to become something you do 3 times a week or 2 times a week. So every Monday, Wednesday, Friday, you go to the gym. Now you start making it a habit, and you start going more often. That's better. But the thing that's under the surface. What we see is that we're going to the gym, but what's starting to happen is that there's a trend starting, a pattern starting to form. But if you really want to change their behavior, you have to give them a structure, because you know that if there isn't a shower to take a shower afterwards, or the gym, it isn't easy to get to the gym, it's too far away, there isn't a bus that gets there, or there's not parking, or the stairs up to the gym, to the locker room, are too hard to get up, or whatever it is, if there's some kind of structural thing that doesn't support it, you're going to stop going. So you need to make sure that the structure is in place to support the patterns, to support the events. But the real way to change people's behavior is to change their mental models. If you get someone thinking, I am an active person, I'm an athlete, I care about my health, and I work out regularly, as soon as you start thinking of yourself in that way, you start to really, everything else falls into place. And so what most people concentrate on when they start trying to change people's behavior is they try to get you to do something a little differently instead of thinking about this. Because if you can change this, everything else falls into place. You'll make a structure. You'll get the patterns, and you'll change the events that happen. So this is the way that I started and our group started thinking about changing people's behavior. And we've worked with a lot of companies and others around that concept. And another thing that we learned is that context is really important. So something looks different when it's placed. Remember I told you when it was an absolute value for my electricity use, I was like, duh, I'm using more. It doesn't mean anything to me. I need to know that I should be doing better. And then that motivates me. It's like the speed limit, where it's if you just knew that you were going 27 miles per hour and you didn't know that you needed to be going 25, you wouldn't change your behavior, right? You need to know what you're trying to get to. So putting it in context, and it changes everything. This little circle in the middle is the same size. I know you don't believe me, but I'll show you in a second. But depending on what's around it, it looks really different. And behavioral economists understand that, and advertisers understand that, and we can trick you. here it is, see? Same size. Go back. It's the same size. The minute, it really doesn't look it, but it is, and it's all because of the context. Isn't that cool? Our brains are so weird. We are so weird, people. Okay, so here's one. This is a study that was done, a famous study. Some of you may have heard about this. So this was done out in Cornell University. And what they did was they got the most disgusting, stale, awful-tasting popcorn they could find. I mean, they made sure that it was awful. And they gave it out for free to people in a movie theater. And some people, they gave it in a big box and some tub. And some people, they gave a small box. And people ate as long as they could because it was free. And then all of a sudden, they'd realize how awful it was and stop. And it turned out that people ate 80% more if they were given it in a big box than in a small box. Context. And if you asked them, if you said, you know, the only reason you ate more was because we gave you a big box, they would say, oh no, I don't fall for that stuff, right? We don't fall for that stuff, we think. We think we're free agents, but in fact, we're being manipulated all the time. So why does that matter? Why does delight fall into it? Well, maybe delight doesn't fall into that necessarily, but it certainly does play an impact. I care about this stuff because You know, if you come back to this thing and we are working with some doctors who are trying to, and we're trying to create technology or do some kind of a thing to get people to eat less. If you didn't understand the context for this, you might think, oh, people are just gluttons. Or you might think, oh, we need to give them some technology and feedback so they eat less. And those people, though, that group of people just naturally eat more. And so we have to just change their behavior and change their events. When in fact, if we change the size of the box, we'll have a huge impact. Right? So a lot of the work that I do is about how do you figure out what the right thing is and how do you get people's attention and deliver it. So how, and delight is one of those ways. And it turns out a lot of people are thinking about delight right now. Google has this thing, random acts of delight, that they're doing. They're all about delight. Apple, surprise and delight, that was their slogan for many, many years. They all want to delight people, but they don't fully understand what it is. And it isn't necessarily just surprise. There's a lot more to it. So I've been working with Professor Talia Wheatley over in Psychology and Brain Sciences to try to understand that. And we're doing a lot of research about what happens in the brain when you experience delight. Nobody seems to be studying that. We study happiness a lot. But delight are these short little moments that happen when you pay attention and when you approach something like it's brand new. And then it meets or exceeds your expectations. And lots about that. And you'll, you know, look for our book. So one person who knew how to delight was Salvador Dali. He really knew how to make people happy. And I had the great pleasure of going to his house in Cadiz, Spain. Has anyone been there to his home? Yes. So you know, it's a small house on the hillside overlooking the ocean. And it's where he worked and where he lived with his wife, Gala. And his studio was there, and there's these giant eggs, and there's these giant stuffed bears and swans everywhere, and this penis-shaped pool. I mean, it's a crazy place. And for whatever reason, when I went there, you can only go in like 6 people at a time, but if you ever are in northern Spain along the coast, you should definitely go. It's really extraordinary. And he has a museum in Figueres that's right nearby there. But for whatever reason, when I went there, I was just sobbing. This was in the fall of 2012. And I was just, you know, it just reminded me of why I started doing this work and how I got into it in the first place was just that magic and, you know, creating stuff that was cool and fun. And I came back and met with Dan Rockmore, who is the director of the Neukom Institute, and said, you know, we're doing all these cool projects, but they're kind of one-offs. And it would be really great if we could do it in a more deliberate and programmatic way. What do you think? And he said, sure. And he gave us some seed funding. So the Neukom Institute gave us seed funding in April of 2013, and we formed the Dali Lab. And it was Dali after my experience in Salvador, you know, at Salvador Dali's home, and then we had to come up with some words that, you know, D-A-L-I, and took us a while to come up with something that would stand for. But digital arts, leadership, and innovation is what we came up with. But really, it's an excuse to use Salvador Dali's name. Don't let anyone fool you. So here's what the lab is. It's a room right now over in Sudikoff in the computer science department where I work. And we've taken over this lab. There are rooms exactly like it above us and below us in the building, but none of them look like this or have this feel. People come in. Folks from Facebook came in and started taking pictures. It's just got a great feel. It's got a blue wall and an orange wall and lots of stuffed animals. And students came in. We opened the doors, had no idea what would happen, who would come in. Turned out students just came in by the droves wanting to be a part of the lab. And we do workshops and activities with the students. We have t-shirts. So what we do is we work with partners from around the world. So we work with faculty members, students, and staff, with nonprofits, with startup companies and large companies. We're talking to a number of large companies about working with them, with government agencies. And they come to us because, as I told you earlier, there's information everywhere. You know, there's information overload. And it's really hard for people to get their messages across, to even get their messages seen, no less to be able to impact people's behavior or get people to think about things in a new way. And so they asked us to help them. So because we had this experience with presenting information in these unique ways and working with a combination of beautiful design and storytelling and animation and technology, people started coming to us and asking us for help. So that's what we do. So here's one of the projects. This is with a professor in Thayer Engineering School. And this is a little device. It's like a little microphone on a Band-Aid. And it reads the sound of coughing and wheezing. And so it's for people with COPD. And we can single out the coughing and wheezing, and it sends the information to a mobile phone, where now qualitative information that you would give your doctor, I was coughing a lot yesterday, or I really was wheezing last week, becomes quantitative information so that the doctors and you, the person, can understand how much you're coughing or wheezing and how it compares to past to other times. It also offers an opportunity to use the smart sensors in a phone. So it can say, you're in Hanover, and the pollen count is really high. And the last time the pollen count was really high, you were really wheezing. So better bring your inhaler or take extra medication. Or I see you're really exercising, and when you exercise a lot, it's a good idea to have this medication. Or if you start coughing a lot, that information can go to the doctor. So that's one of our early projects. We're working with Tom Luxon in the English department on the Milton Reading Room. So this gets 64,000 hits a day. This is the annotated John Milton. Have any of you read Milton? Be honest. Okay. He's hard to read. It doesn't make a lot of sense. But this is the definitive book. So this online source, it's actually, there's no book that's read as much as this. This is one of the first times that an online source has become a definitive reference. And so this, we revamped this website for him and made it much more modern and searchable and all that kind of stuff. This is a project that was just in the news. I'm sorry, did someone have a question? So this is a project that was just in the news because it just got launched. It was in the New York Times. This is one of our first projects that we did. This is with the US Holocaust Museum and the Center for the Prevention of Genocide, and some folks here in the government department, and the Dickey Center. And they were collecting models, statistical risk models, for the risk of the next atrocity worldwide. And an atrocity has a very clear definition, 1,000 civilian deaths by an organized group over a limited period of time. And they were sharing it with the State Department. The State Department would make plans and decisions and policy based around this statistical model. And they decided that they wanted to share it more broadly with others. And so they asked us to do that, to build a web application that would make it possible for other countries, human rights groups, and lay people to understand what's going on, understand what the risks are, understand what causes the risks, makes the place more risky than others. And so we built this web application. It's got this beautiful map. And as you scroll through, the map changes depending on what kind of information it's giving. And it can collect real-time information about what people are looking at and improve their statistical models and stuff like that. So that's live now. We worked with Neukom and with the Hood to create an iPad exploration tool for the Orozco murals. And we work on hubs and maps that bring people together. I just am in the middle of co-writing a grant to help bring disability awareness around the world. We worked with the Children's Environmental Health Center. I was going to show you a website we did to help parents and of young children understand the risks of arsenic in food. And we created this really children's book-like interface and web application to help them with that. Okay. We're working with the National Space and Biomedical Research Institute on the mental duress of long-duration spaceflight. So we were working with Jay Buckey over at the, he's a former astronaut over with at the Geisel School of Medicine. And one of the things that we're doing is creating these virtual reality experiences for people so that while they're up in space, we test it in Antarctica and in Hawaii and other places where people are isolated for a long period of time. But while they're up in space, they could, at the space station or if there's a trip to Mars, they would be able to be immersed in an experience of being home to get some sense of relief from being in this confined little space for a long period of time. We make a lot of mobile apps for people. This one is the what it looks like for the COPD monitor, games, and other kinds of applications. We're working with the psychology department right now to create this app called Appetite, where it builds your willpower. They're doing some research studies about building willpower. Turns out willpower is a muscle, and you can exhaust it. And so this is a way to build it up like any other muscle, so you have more willpower. It's kind of fun. And we did this project called the Cyber Fashion Show, a digital fashion show a few years ago as part of the digital arts exhibition that we do with the music department and the theater department, film department, studio art, and others. And this is a wedding dress. And as the bride is walking down the aisle, there are these little flowers are opening and closing. And when she kisses her partner, these little lights twinkle. This is a 3D printed dress. I call it the no means no dress. And then we had these motorcycle jackets. And this one, when you hit the brake lights, these red LEDs on the back of the jacket flash. And there's another one where there's fringe in the arms, and it's the turn signals. It goes, you know, little LEDs. And it's really fun. So some of our stuff is silly, and some of our stuff is fun. But all of our stuff is, we hope, beautifully designed. So here are the students again working late in the night. 5%, in just 2 years already, 5% of students at Dartmouth will become a Dali member while they're here. We've done 72 projects in 2 years, so 72 different projects for different partners. Most of our projects take about two to three terms to complete. Some of them take longer. Those are, you know, here are the range of different projects that we've done. We have about 20 different projects per term. We work in small teams on big problems. So we put together teams of students, designers, and developers. We force designers to learn how to develop and developers to learn how to design. It's sort of a liberal arts approach to development where people really need to have to understand how to do the whole thing and why it matters. This is all based on, so we take a liberal arts education, we take theory and we put it into practice. This is all done outside of the classroom. It's extracurricular. Students are actually being paid. This is a job for them. They're being paid to work on these projects. And they come in as they apply for the lab. They come in and they have to reapply every term. And students who get accepted into the lab come back. Almost 100% of the students who get accepted into the lab come back term after term after term after term, some staying for as much as the whole 2 years that we've been around. So, yeah, sure.
Do you have to have an academic level to be admitted to
these? No, I'll show you in a second. Freshmen, we have 4 freshmen who joined us this term, this fall. Uh-huh. So it really isn't about their grade, it's about their what kind of experience and what they show us when they apply. Uh-huh. Yeah, they have to submit some work to us. And what they do in the lab, what students do in the lab, is not taught in a classroom. They don't learn this kind of design. They don't learn this kind. They learn problem solving, but not this kind of problem solving. They don't learn user interface and user experience design. They don't learn these kinds of programming languages that we use. They get a strong foundation, so it's very quick for them to learn it. But they're learning these things in the lab. They're also learning a lot of soft skills. They're learning how to communicate with each other and with their partners. Teaching Dartmouth students how to write an email. Oh, my God. It's harder than you would think, right? Teaching, so communicating, working in teams towards a common goal, figuring out how to solve problems, but even more, how to ask the right questions. These are the kinds of soft skills that students learn in the lab. This is an example of the kind of experiential learning that President Hanlon talks about. Right? They're doing experiential learning all the time in the class. They're working on real-world problems with real-world constraints. Partners who have deadlines and limitations in what they need. So they come from all across campus. You don't have to be a CS major, although most of our students are CS majors. But they're chemistry majors, classics, film and media studies, history, all across campus. A lot of the students, we encourage students to just take online courses or take courses at Dartmouth, learn as much as they can, and then apply to the lab. Here's the class year. So last year we had about 13 or 14 freshmen come through last year. So this is one place where freshmen get to work with seniors on a regular basis. It's also an alternate social space for these students. They come into the lab and they hang out. They do their homework there, watch movies, talk, work on their work for the class. So a really distressing thing is that less than 20% of all computer science majors across the country are women, and that number is going down. Here at Dartmouth, we're about 32%, so we're doing better than the average. At Google, I think that about 12% of all of their engineers are women. Here at the Dali Lab, we're nearly 50% women. So here are people again working away in the lab late at night. They work hard, they work long, but they really enjoy it. You know, there's a real sense that they're building something that gives them delight in making it and brings delight to others in allowing them to be able to experience something in a new way and see things that they hadn't necessarily noticed before. So our goal is to help our students create technology tools that are beautifully designed and elegantly made that help our partners to communicate and create this sense of delight amongst our users. We also have a big entrepreneurial bent. We work with Dan a lot and others. So I'll take questions. I will tell you that we only can accept less than 20% of the students who apply to the lab. We have so many applications each term that we're really limited. We have a waiting list of partners that's almost a year long. So we're really just constrained by resources for how big this could get. Yeah.
I think your efforts about the polar bears and climate change is really important. And I think you'd get plenty of grants if you work harder on the climate change issues, because I think a lot of our population is not getting it.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, we continue to work on it, but we'll work harder. It's an important issue, right? It's huge.
Thanks very much for very entertaining and interesting presentation. My question is reflection and evaluation. When you do these projects, do you have time for the students to kind of reflect on them and think about how they might have done them differently or better? And do you build metrics into the projects to see the effect of each project on the desired outcome?
That's a really great question, a really great question. So as far as reflection, we do a lot of reflection. We do reflection amongst the staff and we do reflection with the students. Every term we give students a survey to ask them how they're doing. I meet with almost all of the students at the end of every single term and ask them, what did you get from the lab? What could have been better in terms of the lab experience, in terms of your individual experience? What could you have done better? And how did your project go? So a lot of reflection is a huge piece. We use a process called human-centered design, and a big piece of that design process is the analysis and feedback, finding out from people how things went. We ask our partners, all of our partners, how was it? What worked? What didn't work? So we really need to learn. We see ourselves as a real, in a learning mode. We are just a learning organization trying to figure out how to do. There's nothing like this, by the way, at any other campus, anywhere in the country. There are things that have some pieces of it that are similar, but nothing working with undergrads, which is the Dartmouth thing that is multi-term. A lot of times there's a capstone class or a one single class, but to have it be a big project, you know, ongoing program like this, extracurricular, these kinds of projects, the design element as well as this, as well as the development element, the entrepreneurial piece, there's nothing quite like it, or at least that's what I'm told. And so we need to learn and figure out how to do that and how to do that better. As far as the impact, that's one of the things. So one of our goals, we do this little swath of the life of a project. So we expect our partners to figure out, you know, what it is they need and do the research and create, get the content and come to us when they have a specific need for us to help them design and develop a prototype or a tool to help them get their ideas across. So we do this one little piece. They come in with all the content, and then we hand it over to them, and we say, go, you go make it work and give us the results. So some of it is on the partners to let us know how it goes. But we do know, for example, that people, one thing people want, and you know, we work with Dan. At Dan, people are coming up with these great entrepreneurial ideas. Or we work with Tuck. The Tuck students come to us all the time saying, we've got these entrepreneurial ideas. We need your help actually making something that we can show what you know, we want to do. So sometimes our goal is to make something so they can get the next round of funding, or so they can take it and build a team, or so they can go on to the next level. And we see that very quickly. We have had huge success in helping our partners get more funding or move to the next level or get something out into the world. A lot of our projects, like the arsenic site or the early warning project, are just being released now, so we don't have full results of it. But we do know that we've been very, very successful at helping our partners get to that next step that they wanted to get to and have a tool that they can actually use and implement. So it's a piece we need to work on, for sure. Let's get more. Yeah.
With elections coming up, do you get any influence or questions from political think tanks that want to influence us as to how we vote one way or the other?
That's a brilliant question. Thank you. Yeah. That would be fun. I worked one time with a group of friends who were researchers at NYU who were studying body language, and I snuck into all these political campaigns as a news reporter and videotaped them to read their body language. Anyhow, that's a whole other story. But we haven't been asked to do that, but they know how to do that really well. There's hardly, you know, advertising, the thing is, advertisers and political campaigns have been studying these things forever. They understand it really well. And how do we take some of those, you know, the idea of influencing people, and what we're trying to do is take some of that knowledge that they've got along with the knowledge that we have and try and help do, you know, use it for good, hopefully, you know, to help people do good things in the world.
Oh, there's a follow-up, Lorie.
Yeah.
My follow-up is, are you going to do any studies to help us, the common people, be able to fight that influence so we vote because we want to vote rather than the way people want us to?
Yeah, that would be great. That's a great idea. Let's do that, you and I. We'll do that together. You know, there are a lot of books that have been written. The Heath brothers have written, Dan and his brother, Heath have written books. Dan Ariely has written books about how we just really don't have a free agency, how we're so easily persuaded, and a lot of books around that topic. And I think there is research out there. It's still really hard. I mean, you saw, I had to today take that little circle in the middle and move it over myself to prove to myself that I didn't get that wrong. I mean, even though I made that slide, I didn't believe myself. And so that's why I moved it over and checked it. And I thought, oh, I'll show them that I checked it. It actually is true. So sometimes we think we're doing something. And I think it's really hard. I think it's sort of like advertising. People give us advertising that makes us think that we all should, you know, and images in magazines where people are photoshopped to look completely different, and we think that's the ideal. And the only thing we can do, I think, and maybe you have a better answer, and I'd love to hear yours, is to just be aware, to just do our best to be aware of how we're being manipulated, and at least to say, aha, I get it, I'm being manipulated.
Time for one more question, Lorie? Is there?
Sure, are there any?
Comment. I think as an educator, the fact that you're doing this for the students without having a grade and they're willing to learn, that to me speaks volumes. Because these young men that were this group that we talked to last night, how do they have time to do anything?
Yeah.
And yet, this is something they're very, and it's the up and coming. It's not, you know, I love Shakespeare, but this is something that would be, and the fact that I'd do it and not have to do it for a grade and have to work with other people,
yeah.
Why would I want to do that?
Yeah.
But this
right.
is just terrific.
Right. Thank you. Yeah, a lot of what we're trying to do is exactly that. I mean, we want students to be in a safe place where they can fail, right? We want people to take risks and to try to do something. We tell our partners when they come in, this is going to be messy. These are students. Some of them are going to, you know, do some things that aren't so great, or it'll take them longer. They're doing it on top of classwork, and the classwork is the most important thing they're doing. It's going to take longer than it would have. You're going to have to be more involved than you would have. But the result is going to be much more creative and much more exciting and effective for you, we hope. And that tends to be what happens. And in fact, you know, in terms of, we know that this is working. If one measure is how these students are doing in the real world, we have companies now coming and recruiting directly to the lab. Facebook comes, Google comes, Microsoft comes, small startups come, Palantir comes, consulting companies come. But a lot of people are coming and trying to get, saying, these are the students. This is what we want students to learn. In addition, it's the beautiful mix, it's the magic combo of the liberal arts education from Dartmouth together with this more targeted outside of the classroom experience has proven to be really effective and really powerful for the students and powerful for people who want to hire them. And, you know, so we're starting to see it more and more. We're starting to see high school students who are coming to Dartmouth because of this. Choosing Dartmouth specifically because of the lab. We're seeing that quite often, actually. And it's very exciting to see how those things go together. I don't think it would work if we were not a liberal arts education, liberal arts school out in the woods. So.
Lorie, thank you so much. Really, really great. Thanks.
Thanks, you guys.